Hi, my name's Steve Ringer and welcome to Skill School. Well, today you've joined me at Willowbrook Fishery near Islip on the edge of Northampton. As you can see, I've got a fish on already, and I'm here today to talk to you about one of the most devastating summer tactics, which is the pellet waggler. Let's just see if we can get this one in the net, and then we can go through some of the finer points before eventually dealing with the fun stuff, which is obviously the fishing. As you can see, they do pull a bit in here. See if we can get this one in the net. Here we go. Head up, keep the head up, and there we are. Nice pellet waggler caught carp. One of the great things about Willowbrook is how good looking the fish are. If I can just hold this one up for you in a second. You proper wanted it, just gorgeous job. Just put the rod down a second. There we go. Just hold this beautiful mirror up. They're proper, as the carp boys would call them, wood carvings. If you just want us to straighten out. There we go. A beautiful Willowbrook mirror carp. Perfect scaling, really dark in colour. Right, slip him in the net before we catch a few more. I'll just run you through my setup. Right, so let's talk about my actual setup. Firstly, dealing with rod and reel. Got a $4,000 ballistic reel, loaded with 6-pound sensor main line. 6-pound line for me, perfect for waggler fishing, particularly when the fish are big. They probably average 8, 9, maybe double figures in here. So you're talking about fish that pull pretty hard, so the tackle's gonna be tested to the limit. So 6-pound reel line's the minimum I'd sort of look at using. On the rod front, I've got a Team Daiwa 11-foot pellet waggler rod. I'm a big fan of short rods. I prefer better playing action, and when you get those fish under the rod top, they come that bit closer, so I can net them a little bit easier. So that's your rod, reel and main line. Onto the business end. Firstly, we just talk about float choice. I've got a Daiwa multi-tip pellet waggler. These are new on the market. There's several key characteristics to the float. Firstly, the tip itself, as the name suggests, it's a multi-tip float. You get three tops with it, orange, yellow and black. They just literally screw on and off. Today I'm faced with a black background, well, a really dark background, so orange shows up a treat, so it's an orange top. But if I had a nice white sheen, I could switch to the black. Just nice and easy, means you're not blacking out the tips of your floats, and then they can only be used for one purpose. After that, you've got the flights. Very much as in how a dart arrows dead straight, that's what the flights are there for, to aid accuracy in casting. When I'm feeding quite a tight area or trying to cast at a fish, the flight's just able to me to cast it pinpoint right on the spot I want it to go every time. Then lastly, as you can just see, we've got a little disc around the bottom. That actually serves two purposes. The first is to stop the float diving. So when you cast, I've always been a believer that when you cast, probably 80% of your bites on the pellet waggler come as that float splashes down. So the last thing you want it to do is hit the surface, disappear, and then by the time it comes back up, you've missed your bite. The disc just helps to stop it diving, so it hits the surface, sits straight away, and if that fish takes the bait, you see that bite, and obviously then you can hit it. The other benefit to the disc is it just adds to the anti-eject effect. So when a fish sucks in that hook pellet, it goes to move off, it's got to move, obviously the float plus the disc is adding extra resistance. So it just means you hit more bites, or you hook more fish, so to speak. So that's the float. On the subject of setup, I've tied a twizzle loop probably 5 inches long, and then the float's running between, if you can just see there on either thumb, two gripper stops. Basically what I've done is tied the twizzled loop, say 5 to 6 inches in length, then I've put a gripper stop on and literally moved it up to the top knot. If you can just see that top knot again under my thumb, the gripper stop just sits against that. Then the next step is to thread a little feeder bead in on, again that's just sitting under my thumb there. That's what the waggler's going to attach to, as you can see. And then a second gripper stop is threaded onto that twizzled loop. And then what I do is tie a little loop in the big loop. So on the end of the 5 to 6 inch twizzled loop, say an inch in, I've just tied another overhand loop, and that gives me a buffer. So the two gripper stops are running between the two knots. The two gripper stops are resting on the two knots, and the waggler's running in between. And then my hook length literally attaches double loop to that bottom loop. The reason, you might be thinking, well, why has he got the waggler running between the two? The reason I have the waggler running So I don't have to strike through the float, and secondly, it doesn't tend to tangle. I mean, striking through the float is the big reason. It's quite a big, heavy float to get the distance I need to catch today. So I don't want to be striking through that to make contact with the fish. Because it's running, the float will just collapse on the cast, collapse on the strikes, and then literally it's fish on. Moving down, I've got, you know, I started at about 3 foot today, but I'm down to probably 18 inches. So I've got 18 inches of 019 end gauge hook length, and a size 18 Guru pellet waggler hook, if you can just see there, with a little bait band mounted and an 8mm hard pellet. I mean, you don't need big hooks. I know they are big fish, but I tend to find you get better hook holds with smaller hooks. A common mistake a lot of anglers make, particularly when pellet waggler fishing, is if they lose a few, they go to a bigger hook. Whereas if I lose a couple of fish, I prefer to go to a smaller hook with the view that the fish will take the smaller bait, smaller hook, and the pellet, because it looks more naturally. If you put a bigger hook in, it actually makes your hook bait look even more unnatural, and there'll be a reason why the fish is refusing it in the first place. So smaller hooks, better hook hold, more fish landed as far as I'm concerned. So that's the actual setup. Before we deal with the fishing, let me quickly talk to you about actual baits. I've got two sizes of hard coarse pellets here. Firstly, I've got the big sort of donkey choker 11 mils. These are what I'm feeding. The reason I'm feeding 11 mils is twofold. Firstly, you get a better splash. When you plop them in, you can hear them proper plop on the surface, so they're going to attract more fish. And secondly, I can fish them further out. So like, say everyone around me is feeding 8 mils, if I feed 11 mils, I can fish another 5, maybe even 10 yards further out, get my own bit of water so I'm not competing, and in turn that's going to catch me more fish. And after that, I've got the more standard pellet waggler bait, just 8mm coarse pellets. To be honest, today, as I said, I'm feeding 11s to get that bit of extra distance to the fish, so I'm purely using the 8mm for the hook. You know, I was here the other week doing a feature with Angling Times, and I actually fished and fed 11mm for an hour and a half, 2 hours. And although I had fish in my swim, I couldn't catch. Put an 8mm on the little band on the hair, and all of a sudden I'd 4 fish in half an hour. So feed the big pellet, fish a smaller one on the hook, and it seems to get you more bites. So that's the baits. On the subjects of feeding, it's literally little and often. So it's a case of taking 4 11mm, dropping them in the pouch like so, and just pinging them out. You know, I mean, basically, unless I'm casting, twitching, or playing a fish, the secret is never to put your catapult down. So that's my setup, rigs, bait and feeding. It's time to do some fishing. As I've said, pellet waggler fishing is all about building up a rhythm. So it's a rhythm of cast, the waggler plop in. You're looking for bites instantly, because bites can come within a second of the float hitting the water. Then feed, so it lands just short of the float like that. Twitch your hook bait straight into the loose feed, so them loose fed pellets are falling, and my hook pellet is falling in amongst them. Then feed again, just short of the float. Just draw it back in again. Let it plop up, let it fish for sort of 5 seconds, 3, 4, 5. Any of them loose offerings now are going to have sort of gone out that window of opportunity. So it's a case of repeating it and just getting into that rhythm that I talked about. It's all about trying to make your hook pellet appear as naturally as possible. So if it's just sitting there suspended in mid-water, it doesn't appear very natural. Whereas if it's falling along with the loose offerings, then it looks just like it's just been loose fed. Carp's going to take it with a lot less suspicion. So as you can see, I just fed then, drew the float back in. Feed a few more. Draw in again. And there's no bites. There's a few fish milling about, but no bites, and just repeat it and just keep going. It's one of those methods where you can go sort of 20 minutes without a bite and get 4 in 4 casts, but when the 4 weigh the best part of 40 pounds, you're soon on the way to a big weight. And there you go. It's probably took 5 minutes of feeding, cast, twitch to get the fish back in the swim, but I started to see a few dark shapes cruising about, and sure enough, we got a fish on. This one actually came on the twitch as opposed to the splash. So I cast, fed, drew it into the feed, the float didn't pop up, rod top round, and you know it's fish on. On the subject of playing them, I always like to keep the rod nice and low. Just helps to keep the fish pretty much straight in front of me on tight pegs on commercials. You don't want them running across other people's lines. And also it means they're not getting the impression that I'm trying to pull them out of the water. When you've got the rod high in the air, I always think the fish feels like you're pulling it out of the water. This way, keeping the rod nice and low, keeping pressure to a minimum, then if the fish does move, just nice and smooth when you're changing the angle. Looks another typical sort of 7-8 pound fish. A really dark fish again. Once you get them under the rod top like this one is now, it's all about just taking your time, making sure the fish comes into the net. I've got the clutch set, so if the fish does make a run, then that's going to give line. So I've only got to worry about getting the fish in the net. Once you've got its head up, there we go. Have we got it? No. Round again. There we are, in the net. Another really dark mirror carp. Stunning looking fish again though.
Well, we've had a few more fish on the waggler for probably 12, 13 pound, but this one is something a bit different. Just got to keep it out from underneath these stagings. This is certainly a lot bigger. Just weighed him, 21 pound of pellet waggler caught mirror carp. Now don't get me wrong, this isn't the normal stamper fish to be caught on the pellet waggler, but it just goes to show what can be achieved. Right, let's just slip him back. Well, there you go, there's my guide to pellet waggler fishing. On hot days like this, it really is an unbeatable tactic, and if you follow my advice, get it right, you too could be catching a fish just like that one.